Hello there and welcome back to my channel. Today, I'm going to be answering your questions. I have not done a Q&A video in a while, so I reached out to you all through Instagram stories and asked you what questions you had for me. So today, I'm going to answer them. Now, keep in mind that I am pre-recording this video, so currently it is September 28th. The reason I am pre-recording some videos is because the month of October is going to be crazy. I get married in less than 2 weeks, and then Billy and I are going on a honeymoon, so I have a lot of sub plans to write, and it's just going to be crazy. As a result, I wanted to make sure I still had videos to put out to you all, and I was still consistent, so I am sitting down today and just recording a bunch of videos. So as I'm answering these questions, keep in mind, you are seeing this on like November 1st, I think, but I'm actually recording this at the end of September. Now, when it comes to these questions, I left it very open-ended. So there's some personal ones and there's some teaching ones. I'm gonna start with like the personal questions and then I'll move on to the teaching ones. So let's start with this one. Are you guys excited to tie the knot? Yes, very much so. We're starting to get a little bit nervous. We're each writing our own vows. I think that's what we're most nervous about. But yes, we are very excited. Do you have your wedding dress picked? Yeah, the wedding's in less than 2 weeks. Now, because we had to move our like full ceremony with all of our family and friends to next year, the wedding dress that I originally bought, which I got like well over a year ago, I'm gonna save that for next year. This wedding ceremony that we're gonna have is gonna be very small and intimate. And as a result, I didn't wanna wear that dress because it's a little too fancy. I ended up getting a new dress off of Lulu's. It was less than $100, super excited about it. And I did have to get it hemmed because I'm short. I actually went and picked up the dress from the seamstress this morning. And now that I say that, I realize I left it in my car, so I should probably go get that. But yes, wedding dress is picked. How are you so productive? Are you a type A personality? Yes, 100%, I am very type A. In terms of being productive, I thrive in productivity. I feel stressed out when I'm not being productive, and as a result, I try to maintain being productive to prevent that stress. But I also live by the phrase, activity leads to more activity and inactivity leads to more inactivity. So I know personally when I have a day where I wake up and I start tackling my to-do list from the get-go, I feel so much better and I'm a lot more productive than days where I kind of start a little sluggish and I'm like, no, I'll do that later. I end up not doing it at all. So I just keep that in mind and it allows me to be more productive. What future plans do you and Billy have? So we are looking to buy a house next spring / early summer. Our lease is up in this current townhouse at the beginning of July, so we're wanting to purchase a house a little bit before that so we have time to like move everything. But I will let you all know we are looking at moving to another state. I'm not gonna tell you what state yet, but we just need a change. We both have lived in Maryland our whole lives and now's the time to do it. Like, we don't have a family yet or a reason to really be tied down. So I think we might end up moving somewhere else, but you'll have to stay tuned to figure out where. What got you into weightlifting? It's more of who got you into weightlifting. So that is 100% thanks to Billy. I was a runner in high school. I did cross country, indoor track, outdoor track. I had never really done weightlifting. When Billy and I first started dating, he had a gym membership at a World Gym that was near us and I ended up signing up with him. But we would go in and I would go to the treadmill and run and he would go work out. At some point though, he just got me to try it. And as soon as I tried lifting weights, I realized I loved it. I think it's extremely empowering, just feeling that increase in strength. And I like seeing how I physically am able to change my body by building muscles. I just think it's really awesome. So yeah, that is completely thanks to Billy. Where are you planning to go on a honeymoon? So we had previously told you all about going to Greece. However, that is not a possibility right now because they are not open to US citizens. So we are gonna still go to Greece, but it's gonna be next year after our wedding. I kind of feel like we deserve two honeymoons after everything that we've had to do and all the changes we've had to make. So this year we are actually going to the Maldives. I wasn't gonna tell you all, but because this video is going up after the fact, I can tell you all. The only reason we are going to the Maldives, well, a couple reasons. Number one, they are open to US citizens. But number two, we got a fantastic deal. We are staying in one of those overwater bungalows, which has always been a dream of mine, but I never thought I'd actually be able to go because they're like $1,000 a night. And there's no way we could have afforded that. But we're staying at the W Maldives Resort, which is a Marriott property. And Billy's sister works for Marriott, so we do get discounts. Now, even with the discount, still insanely expensive. But because they were closed down and just started reopening for tourists, we were able to snag a phenomenal deal. Y'all, we are getting this room for like $159 a night.
Crazy. What a deal.
What? And it has like a private pool and a deck that leads right out to the Indian Ocean. Like, oh my goodness. And when we saw it for that price, we just said, you know what? We have to do it. So we are still gonna go to Greece next year, but thankfully due to that phenomenal discount, we are able to have two honeymoons and go to a crazy nice place that otherwise we never would have been able to travel to. So you know, 2020 is actually kind of looking up. Are you voting this year? Yes, 100%, absolutely. And if you are eligible to vote, you need to vote as well. What's your workout routine? What foods do you eat in a typical day? So I got a lot of questions, not only through this, but also just on Instagram about my kind of fitness journey slash losing weight. A lot of you have noticed that I have lost weight recently. Now, I want to start by saying I am not in any way promoting weight loss. I personally chose to lose body fat for fitness reasons. I am wanting to compete in powerlifting, and so I wanted to cut down to a smaller weight class so I could be more competitive. And I have spent several years now building muscle, and I wanted to see aesthetically what my body would look like if I lost body fat. So that's kind of my motivation behind it, but in no way did I think that I needed to lose weight. I did it for fitness purposes. Now, in terms of how I did it, I track macros. So your macronutrients are protein, carbs, and fat. Protein and carbs each have 4 calories and a gram of fat has 9 calories. I knew about where my body was for maintenance, meaning I'm not gaining weight, I'm not losing weight. And from there, I put myself in a deficit. That meant I'm eating less food than what my body is burning. Keep in mind, your body burns food whether you're moving or not. So like if you just sat there all day and didn't move a muscle, your body is naturally burning energy. Plus, if you're then moving around and walking anywhere, plus if you're working out. Plus, when you eat food, technically, your body is using energy in order to digest the food. There's whole like science behind it, but I just put myself in a slight caloric deficit, which meant I was eating less than what my body was burning, and that allowed me to lose weight. I at no point was doing cardio. I mean, I would go for like walks, but that was more so enjoyment. I was not doing cardio in order to lose weight. In terms of my workout routine, so Billy and I do 4 days on, 1 day off. That ends up working out to either 1 day off per week or 2 days off per week, just depending on when those rest days fall. We will do a deadlift day, and then in addition to deadlift, we will focus on either hamstrings or back. Then we do a bench day, and in addition to bench, we will do either shoulders or chest. Then we do a squat day, and we focus on either quads or glutes. And then we do an arm day where we do triceps and biceps, and then we take a rest day, and then we repeat. And we kind of alternate, so if the first deadlift day we did hamstrings with it, the next deadlift day we'll do back instead. Literally, we just kind of made this up. Well, actually, I made it up.
Of course you did.
But that's our workout routine. And then in terms of food, what I typically eat in a day, I have a protein coffee for breakfast. I've never been someone who's super hungry in the morning. So for me, I don't need a big breakfast. I will mix some iced coffee with protein powder and drink that. That usually holds me over until lunch. For lunch, I have a sandwich, turkey, cheese, and mustard, and then I have grapes, not grapes. Why did I say grapes? I literally don't even remember the last time I ate a grape. I have strawberries and blueberries, and then I will typically have a Greek yogurt in the afternoon as a snack, and then we will have dinner, which our dinners vary. We try to keep them lower carb, not for any reason particular. I love to eat all my carbs at night before bed. That's really the reason why, but we'll have like a sweet and sour chicken, or we'll have barbecue chicken, or we'll have taco salad. Like, we totally mix up our dinners. And then at the end of the day before bed, whatever macronutrients I have left, so my carbs, proteins, and fats, I eat a bunch of snacks before I go to bed. I tend to eat a lot of carbs before bed just because that's when I enjoy having them and that's what works for me. That's it. That's what I've been doing for those of you who are curious. Ooh, are you planning on taking any more grad classes? Billy and I have discussed the possibility of us each going for our PhDs. He will finish his master's at the end of this year by like December. And we've talked about after that, like each of us going into a PhD program, but I don't know because I'm also really busy and grad school was hard to balance with everything. So I don't know if I really want to do that. But if Billy does it, I have to do it. I'm not letting him get his doctorate and me not have it. So I don't know. We'll see. Will you take Billy's last name since you built a brand with yours? Yes, I am going to take his last name. To me, my brand has nothing to do with my name. It's who I am as a person and the ideas that I share. The name attached to it really doesn't matter. Plus, honestly, Billy has been such a pivotal element within my brand. I started it while him and I were together. And honestly, I don't think I would have been able to do a lot of the things that I have done if it were not for him, because he takes care of the cooking, he takes care of the cleaning, he helps me out with filming sometimes. Like if I need support, he's always there to jump in. And so honestly, so much of my success is thanks to him and his support. So if anything, I think taking his last name is a good way to kind of honor that role he has played in me building my brand, if that makes sense. What is your morning routine? I need something I can get into. I feel like I change my morning routine every few weeks. I currently sleep in as late as possible, which tends to be like 6:45, sometimes 7. I do not shower in the morning because I shower at night when I get home from the gym. I will get up, I will go ahead and change into whatever clothes I'm wearing, which if I'm staying at home, I'm probably wearing something comfy from the waist down. And then I will go into my little get ready room. I'll quickly do my makeup and my hair. And then I go downstairs, I will make my protein coffee. If I'm teaching from my classroom, I have to also pack my lunch. But if I'm teaching from home, I don't have to pack my lunch. And then I grab my bag and I leave. Like literally, I try to keep it as simple as possible because I'm not a morning person. How are the kitties? They're good. They're currently hiding because I had someone come and power wash like our house and our steps earlier. And so when they knocked on the door, the cats went and hid and they don't come out for hours afterward. Luna always hides under the comforter. And Zora, honestly, I have no idea where she goes because I can never find her. And eventually she just shows up again. But yeah, they're good. All right. I'm gonna have this be the last personal question and then we'll jump over to teaching questions. Where'd you get your glasses from? It is so funny to me that I've shared this in so many videos, yet I'm constantly asked. These are from EyeBuyDirect. I can't remember off the top of my head what the frames are called, but I will link them for you. And I'm pretty sure I have a code for like $10 off your first pair or something like that. So that will be down there. All right, now let's jump over to teaching questions. So I'm gonna scroll back down to the bottom. Do you prefer upper elementary or primary elementary? Upper. How do you organize your Google Drive? I have an entire video on that, so I will link it for you. How are you keeping students engaged online? My students are having difficulties. Okay, this is definitely hard. One thing that has really worked for me is using Nearpod to teach all of my lessons because I am then in control of the slides on the screen for my students, and I can add in interactive elements like games and polls and videos that they can participate in. So for me, that's been a game changer. I did make a video all about how I create a Nearpod lesson from start to finish, so I will link that for you as well. Advice for going into student teaching. Ask as many questions as you can and go into it with a growth mindset, knowing that you're going to get feedback of things you have to improve upon, and just take that feedback and run with it and make the changes and constantly reflect on your practices and ask questions to figure out how you can be better. Oh, and take time for yourself because it is very overwhelming and you have to, you know, put your mask on before you help someone else. So do that. Even my strongest students have difficulty problem solving suggested strategies. I would say to do think alouds. So basically model your thinking as you're solving a problem. That's going to help students utilize those problem solving strategies on their own. Oh my gosh, there's hair in my mouth. bleh, but just modeling your own thinking and giving students some kind of a process to follow. So first having them read the question and maybe jot down anything they notice, and then jot down questions that they have, and then go back and find those key elements and really try to visualize the problem. Like, it depends on what kind of problem they're solving, but model the process for them again and again and again, and then have students share their own processes and allow them to listen to their peers. And it is a struggle though, just keep doing it. Do you ever think you'll go back to teaching K-3 by choice, meaning that you would do it because you want? Honestly, no. I would love to just stay in fourth grade because I love fourth grade. How do you take the time to create units and lesson planning for different levels? Honestly, I think teachers, overthink differentiation. Differentiation doesn't have to be this big, crazy thing, and it doesn't have to be planning several different lessons. It's just tweaking elements of it. So when you think about differentiation, there's three different ways, well, technically four. Okay, I'm gonna focus on three. So process, content, and product, also technically environment, but let's just focus on those three. So for process, that's how the student's going to learn. That might be giving some students an audiobook and other students a physical book, or giving some students a video and other students, you know, a paper article, like knowing their preferred styles of learning and adapting your lessons to fit that. In terms of the content, that can be as simple as having different levels of a text, or having a broken down version of a text if it's too complex, or maybe having parts already highlighted for the student. And when it comes to the product, that's just giving students choice in what they create. Or maybe you're gonna give them a graphic organizer that will help them get their thoughts down. It doesn't have to be this whole changing of the lesson, it's just doing these little things to tweak it. Give them manipulatives, give them a highlighter to use, chunk the assignment for them. It doesn't have to be super complicated. How are you having SPED teachers work with you during Google Meets? I'm AACPS too. So this is someone who also teaches in my county. I currently do not have a special educator that I am working with for my class. However, in the spring, I did have the co-taught reading and the co-taught math class. So I was working with a special educator. She had her own Google Classroom, and she would create differentiated options for her students and push them out through there. Depending on the student, sometimes I had to check their assignment on my Google Classroom, sometimes I had to check it on hers, but she was a co-teacher on mine and I was a co-teacher on hers, so that was never really a problem. But in the spring, we didn't do a lot of live instruction. I know currently one of my team teachers that is working closely with a special educator is also using Nearpod like me. And so the special educator can actually log into the Nearpod just like she can, and then can run the live lesson and resume the same session and be able to see student responses in real time. So that's something that's working for them. But right now, that's not really something that I am doing just because of the makeup of my class. Are there any social emotional activities that you're doing with your students? So I'm lucky, we actually use a program called Second Step, which is an entire curriculum based around social emotional learning. And we do it during our morning meeting time. So every week there's a lesson that focuses on a different like skill or topic, like empathy or active listening. And we just complete the lessons with them during morning meeting. I know that's probably not super helpful, but go on to Instagram and search like the hashtag for social emotional learning, and I'm sure you'll find tons of ideas. What most important things to focus on when teaching in 2020? Building relationships with your students. I think now more than ever, students truly need those close relationships, not only with each other, but with their teachers, because we're all feeling stressed and there's so many changes. And I think we all feel pressure because of the way the spring ended. We're feeling the pressure to get students caught up. And so we're just thinking academics, 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 when we really need to be focusing on the mental health aspect of our students. And so really focusing on those relationships, I think that that's most important. Ooh, this is a good one. With online teaching, how do substitutes / sick days work? So my county is actually not doing any substitutes. We have to pull from in-house staff. So TAs, or some of our literacy teachers, or like administration even, like they are the ones covering for us for sick days or for days when we're out. Because we are flexible and can teach from home or in our classroom, sick days I don't think are as important as they used to be. Like, I know if there was a day where I wasn't feeling great, I might just teach from home that day and not worry about taking an actual sick day. But obviously things do come up. I personally am taking off 6 days for my honeymoon. I was able to find a TA who was long-term subbing for a second grade teacher, and that ended like a week before my honeymoon. So she is going to be my substitute during my honeymoon. But yeah, that's what we're doing for subs. It's all just in-house people. Okay, I'm gonna pick out like two more because I feel like this video is getting really long. What is your favorite purchase for your virtual learning that you've got this year? Ooh, I actually haven't bought a whole lot. I would say probably my document camera, which I've shared in a few different videos, but I will also link it down below. I love that I can use it as a document camera and as a webcam. I can just flip it down or flip it up, and I don't have to like install any software. I literally just plug it in the computer and it's ready to go. Otherwise, I would probably say the gold membership on Nearpod. So it allows me to store more lessons and have more space. That was something that I personally purchased out of my own pocket because I'm using Nearpod so much. So I guess that would technically count as a purchase. So yeah, one of those. Okay, this is a good last question to finish on. I've answered it before, but whatever, I'll answer it again. How did you know you wanted to be a teacher? So I was definitely that person that knew at a very early age that I wanted to be a teacher. I distinctly remember sitting in second grade, which first of all, I had a phenomenal second grade teacher. I think he was a lot of the inspiration behind my desire to be a teacher. But I just remember watching him and sitting there in class thinking, that's what I want to do. And I never changed my mind. The only thing I ever considered outside of teaching was something like graphic design or marketing related. And so it's interesting to see how that all kind of came together because I do a lot of that through my product creation. But yeah, for me, it was something that intrigued me. I used to hold school on my front porch. It was just something that I always knew that I really wanted to do. I loved kids growing up. I loved babysitting. I loved helping them with their homework. And yeah, I mean, I guess if you're not in a position where you have that desire, sometimes it is hard to make the decision. But I think just ask yourself, would you be happy doing this for the rest of your life? And if the answer is yes, then go for it. And if it's not yes, then find something else that is a yes. Because if it's not a heck yes, then it should be a no. Okay, that's gonna be it. I feel like I have been rambling on forever, but I hope you all enjoyed this video. If you did, please give it a thumbs up. Go ahead and hit that subscribe button and the notification bell so you don't miss any future videos. As always, thank you for watching. I love you all so much. Don't forget to put your positive pants on, and I will catch you in the next one.